Hello and assalamu alaikum. This is lecture number 20, and in this particular part of the lecture I will be discussing about the shadowing effect that affects the overall efficiency of the production of or efficiency of this solar cell, and also I will discuss about the temperature effects that are associated with the change in overall efficiency. So shadowing effect occurs when a photovoltaic system does not receive the same amount of incident radiation level throughout the system due to some obstacles which might be blocking the sunlight. The system corresponds to this type of disturbances by reducing the overall efficiency. In these conditions, the cell receiving a lower level of radiance level, like in this example, this array is shadowed and it will not be producing any electrical current. So the cell receiving a lower level of radiance can absorb the power instead of producing it. Solar panels work best when there is no shade upon them. In fact, the shadow cost on even just a part of a solar panel in your solar array can potentially compromise the overall output of the whole system. Although the performance and therefore the return of investment from a solar panel system can be severely affected by shading, especially shading that occurs regularly due to an object that casts a shadow at the same time every day as the sun passes through the sky. There are a number of ways which we can adopt to mitigate the shadow effect. The first or the most obvious one is placing our solar panel array where there will be no regular shading. And the next one is using a spring inverter that has a maximum power point tracking capability. Maximum power point tracker helps to minimize the output losses associated with partial shading and other panel output mismatches. Inverters without maximum power point tracking system capability simply lose the output from weaker string once it passes below the required output threshold. Solar panels with micro inverters are the best equipped to combat the shade issues, because each solar panel has individual controller in it, and if one panel is completely shaded, so it won't be able to impact the power produced by the other one. So here is in this example, these are the curves of current and voltage. Here is the spring current on y-axis, and on the x-axis is the operating voltage VOP over the knee region. For the points where VOC is less than the operational voltage, open circuit voltage is less than the operational voltage, and for the this region VOC, open circuit voltage, is less than the open operational greater than the operational voltage. So this is the curve for fully illuminated string, and some power will be lost if one module is shadowed. However, if 10 modules are shaded, this curve indicate that the string will contribute to no current. So this is an example. The controller in this case is the diodes. Diodes are connected in such a way that they allow unidirectional flow of current and reject the reverse current. So the shaded regions will not be able to absorb energy, and the remaining, which are non shaded panels or solar cells will continue to provide the electric current. The bypass diode splits the long strings into sections like these. This is the first section, this is the second section, and so on. Bypass diode of a section bypasses that section if the section is shadowed. So in that case, it would be absorbing the power that is produced by the remaining non-shadowed cell. Now I will discuss about the temperature effects. So alpha and beta are the respective temperature constants that are associated with the current and the voltage. The short circuit current and the open circuit voltage is given by these formulas, where I naught and V naught are the values of the short circuit current and the open circuit voltage at a reference temperature. The net power can be obtained by multiplying the short circuit current and open circuit voltage at a certain temperature. So these equations will lead to V naught times I naught multiplied by these factors, 1 plus alpha delta T and multiplied by 1 minus beta delta T. So if we multiply these, we get 1 plus beta alpha T plus alpha delta T plus alpha beta delta T. The term alpha beta delta T square can be ignored because of its small value, and the power equation can be reduced to P naught times 1 plus alpha minus beta times delta T. So this is the temperature relative curve for summer, and it is 50 degree centigrade, and the other one is for a colder climate, and the temperatures are around minus 150 degree centigrade. We can see from these curves that decrease in VOC, open circuit voltage, is higher as compared to the increase in short circuit current. Therefore, the output power will decrease with respect to temperature. Similarly, these are the two PV curves. The dotted one indicates the curve with higher temperature, and the smooth curve shows the power delivery at the lower temperatures. From the previous slide, we can see that the area under the curve for the hotter climate, that is around 50 degrees centigrade, the area under the curve is smaller, and for the colder regions, the area under the curve will be larger. So this can be translated from this curve that at higher temperatures, the overall maximum power is reduced as compared to the overall curve that is operating at the lower temperatures. So the module should be designed to adjust its output voltage with changing temperature in order to get the maximum power output at any temperature. Now I will discuss about the climatic effects. The solar cells can produce 80% of the full sun power in partially cloudy conditions, and when the climatic conditions are extremely cloudy, the overall production can reduce up to 30%. The snow does not collect on the module as it is angled to to receive the sunlight, so it is basically inclined, so it rejects the collection of snow. And also the solar panels are designed in such a way to withstand a hail of a size of a golf ball.